good morning. That's your wake-up call. Amen. We are thankful for the sound crew, all of them back there. There's a lot going on, lots of buttons, lots of things to do. So thank you for all that you guys do and gals. Amen. Welcome this morning. It's a beautiful day. Always wonderful to start our day out in the house of the Lord to worship Him in spirit and in truth. So good to be here. I do have a few announcements to go over before we go on with our service. Once again, just a reminder, Meals on Wheels, it is our time to deliver those in the community in August, our turn for that month. So between today and next Sunday, we need to get that calendar filled up, which is totally empty at this point. And the next time we'll do it is in January. So if you're thinking, well, I'm not doing it then, well, August would be a good warm month to deliver. It's a blessing to the people, wonderful blessing. And it's a joy to do it. They are so thankful. So joining the generations there right below in your bulletin, this is the high school youth group is doing it this year. This is not the Golden Age banquet. This is something, first time we're doing this, those from our congregation 65 and up, you should have received a notice about it. We had asked for you to respond by last Wednesday. We really need you to respond today if you have forgotten whether you are coming or not. And the high school youth on that Monday, the 31st, we need you all here at 9 in the morning till noon. We'll give you a break and then have you come back later afternoon. It's going to be a great time. Looking forward to it. This is not in the bulletin, this movie I mentioned last Sunday called Call to Freedom. It's in Vyberg. Ann and I haven't got there yet, just haven't had time, but we've heard lots of good things about it. What's it about? It's about human trafficking, unfortunately. But things that need to be known. It shows, I believe, tonight yet, I think 7:30, and then Wednesday night, I believe, at 7:30. All right. I have care center service this afternoon at 2 o'clock. You're welcome to come join us if you would like. The banquet, that's coming up. We serve that in Yankton on August 10th. A lot of the stuff is filled. Thank you for that. There's a few spots left out there. The sheets are in the social hall. And there's a box out there, you'll notice, that has a bunch of apples on it. Not real apples, but paper apples. So this is something new this year. Tricia Fisher and Molly Huber are coordinating this, trying to help the families who just have, it's not easy to come up with all the supplies, I will say it that way. So that you pick an apple off the box, or two, or three, there's lots of items there. Pick that apple off, see what it says, you get those items, bring them back, maybe stick the apple back on and put it in the box between now and August 16th. So sort of like the angel tree that happens at Christmas. It's similar to that. Last announcement that I'm going to, anyway. So one thing that is happening again is they're allowing like women's groups to come back into our care center. Really first time since COVID. So it's exciting. Ann Schultz has got a Tuesday, August 15th. I'll try to get this in the bulletin next Sunday, but if you jot it down, it's a Tuesday, August 15th at 2 for our women. We'll have a program, fellowship with the residents. Lastly, please take time to read all of that part on the insert. There's Christian Ed meeting coming up, Sunday school teachers meeting coming up. Confirmation meeting with parents coming up. I'm not going to read them all. That's why they're here, right? Okay. Let's bow our heads in prayer, please. Heavenly Father, what a joy it is, what an honor and privilege to come and worship you in all of your majesty. We read throughout the scriptures of the activity that takes place before the throne of God, the angels singing, all the believers, the heavenly host who've passed on and are there before your throne, just singing, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, and worthy you are to receive blessing and honor and glory and praise and power." And how magnificent that is, Lord. And we get to participate in that as we gather as the body of believers on this earth, singing of your faithfulness and your goodness. As we'll shortly sing, "Thou changest not, thy compassions, they fail not. Your mercies are new every morning." And this is a beautiful morning. No matter who has come, no matter what the problems might be, what the challenges might be, you know each one of us by name, and you know what we're going through. Maybe it's a happy day. I hope it is. Maybe it's a very difficult day. But Lord, you can turn our weeping into joy, our mourning into dancing. You can do that. And I ask for you to move among us this day by the power of your Spirit, touching each of our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, let's stand once again, please, and we'll sing this beautiful hymn, "Great is Thy Faithfulness," 139. Great is thy faithfulness, O God my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassions they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever wilt be. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Summer and winter and springtime and harvest, sun, moon, and stars in their courses above, join with all nature in manifold witness to thy great faithfulness, mercy, and love. And great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Pardon for sin and a peace that endureth, thy strength and to guide, strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings all mine with 10,000 beside. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord. Sing the chorus one more time. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Amen. You know, before you're seated, just a moment. Maybe you've thought of this, but it just came to me on the last line of the third verse where it says, blessings all mine with 10,000 beside. You know, the writer of this hymn probably 150 years ago had a heads up on that before ever the guy who wrote 10,000 Reasons, right? Take a moment, greet each other, please, before you're seated. Okay, joys and concerns. I have several things written down. I'll start with a joy. Tyson and Becca Haas, Mark and Joy's son and daughter-in-law. Becca had a baby girl this last Monday. Her name is Eliza. Am I saying that correct? Eliza. They live down in a suburb of Austin, Texas now. 6 pounds. 14 ounces, so congratulations to Mark and Joy. Also, I mentioned this last week, I believe, but prayers for Robert and Abby Shane Fish, their little baby girl, Shaylee. She's born with a cataract on her one eye, so they'll be going to Mayo Clinic the end of this week for surgery on that. We praise the Lord for what they can do in these days. Also, Andrew and Alyssa Hora's little baby, Eloise. She did have that heart surgery this last week. It went well. And anything else you want to say? Or just... Wow, praise the Lord. Okay, yes, the surgery went very well. If recovery goes well, then they might get to come back to Brookings in 2 or 3 weeks. So we continue to pray for them. This was on prayer chain, but my dad, he had a fall 2 weeks back and staples in the back of his head, and then in the hospital. And this week, Thursday this week, we brought him here to the Mental Care Center where... Okay. Sorry. We are glad that he's here. We are. He needs full care. He's lost all strength in his legs. But his mind is good, and it's the best place for him to be, right here at our care center. Yeah. Sorry. Okay, let's get on here. All right. Jamie Kozurek, she's doing our projection today. Her mom, Jackie Scott, has lung cancer and has been going through immunotherapy treatments, and she has scans this coming Wednesday, so prayers there. Also, Gary and Sally Seiler, just continued prayers for Gary. He had his leg amputated 3 months back. Been having really, really bad pains. Even today, it's a trip, it sounds like, back to the hospital in Yankton. They're calling it that phantom pain. Trying to get it under control. He will have his 3-month PET scan tomorrow. So, you know, that for any of you who've been through the cancer and the struggle, have family, you know, that can be an anxious time, waiting for those scans. So prayers for them. Continued prayers for Ken Stepanik's mom, Deanna. She's They're still doing tests and things. She's got cancer as well, stage 4, so prayers there. Let's see. The Mad Frogs, they won their first district game on Friday night, and they play, I won't say who they played. Okay. They play Tabor this evening, I believe, at 7:30-ish. Right, Caleb? Okay, so we got about 4 guys-ish from our church on the team. Okay, good. So anything else over here? Yes, Brian. Yeah.
We got some good friends in Mitchell that are doing, they do a lot for the community, and they're doing a matching donation. They're renting a movie theater for kids to come for free to see the movie. And so, if you want to donate anything at all, just have to get to call me, and I'll line it up with the free tool.
Okay. When is the showing up there?
I think they were there this weekend, but I don't know if it all finished this week. I don't know.
Okay. Okay. All right. Brian was just sharing about the Call to Freedom. It's showing at Mitchell. There's some people that have rented the theater for a special showing for anybody to come in for free, correct? Okay. You can talk to Brian afterwards, or if you want to help for the expense of renting the theater, talk to Brian Melhoff. Thank you. Okay, over here. Okay. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, as we think about that movie, Call to Freedom, and what it deals with, human trafficking, it's hard for us to comprehend such evil. But we know that the devil comes to steal, kill, and destroy in whatever way he can. But Jesus, you came to bring life and to give life, and that more abundantly. We pray that this movie will have a powerful effect across our nation to open eyes of what is taking place and maybe what can be done to help these people out of the grips of such slavery. We thank you, Lord, for doing a work there. We pray, thank you for Tyson and Becca Haas, and we just rejoice with them, and Mark and Joy, another granddaughter for them, Eliza, a beautiful little girl, and we ask your blessing upon them. We pray for Robert and Abby and little Shaylee as they go to the Mayo Clinic the end of this week for her surgery to remove that cataract. Thank you, Lord. Such a delicate thing to happen, but you've given them wisdom, and we know it's from you, and we ask for you to work through them with skill and precision, those doing this procedure, and let your peace guard them all the way there and back. For Eloise Hora, Lord, a big surgery that happened this week. Thank you that it went well. We trust you for continued healing now. She's just a few months old, and thank you for renewing her strength. It's been a journey, quite a journey, but you've walked with them through it all, and you will continue. We know that. On that note, we have a few in our congregation with child. Emily Melhoff, due any time, and she's here with us today, and we just thank you for her and Devin and going before them and being with Emily through the delivery time, and others in our church too with little ones in the womb as you knit them together so miraculously. Watch over them all. We pray for Gary and Sally Seiler. Lord, as Sally reached out to me this morning, and Lord, my thoughts immediately went to the man we call blind Bartimaeus. And when he saw you coming, Jesus, he hollered out, "Jesus, thou Son of David, have mercy upon me." And that is our prayer, Lord. For Gary and Sally, it's been a tough go here after that amputation. And we call out to you, Jesus, Son of David, our healer, our deliverer, redeemer. Have mercy upon Gary and Sally. We pray for healing throughout his body. Let those nerves settle down in that phantom pain, as it's called, and relief to come. And we pray that as the scans happen tomorrow, that the results can be good. Lord, there's so many in the cancer battle, lots of names in our bulletin, and And we all know different ones. We pray for Jamie's mother, Jackie Scott, as she has scans this Wednesday. We ask for your healing mercies through her body, Lord. For Jerome and Kathy Nuss and Ken Stepanik's mom, Deanna, and just so many different ones. You know them all. We stand in the gap on their behalf. Two unspokens this morning, Lord. One, a surgery coming up on Tuesday, and you know the details, and you know the name. We thank you for going before that one. One that had a major surgery this last week, and you know his name, and we trust that the healing continues through his heart, Father, in Jesus' name. Thank you, Father, for the Mad Frogs. Yeah, our town team. Help them to do well this evening in their game, all those that play. Lord, you've blessed us with some good rains. Yes, it's probably time for some more to come. We thank you that you've spared us from hail and bad storms that have certainly been in our state, and we pray for those who have endured damage of hail and wind and whatever it might be. Lord, we just ask for your protection over the crops, that you'd continue to provide the rain to bring them to the fullness of the harvest. We thank you, Father, for that. As we pray for our nation daily and here together, bring revival to this land, bring healing to our land, Lord, it's only through you. And we humble ourselves and come before you and ask for you to heal this land. Open the eyes of the people to see that you are the way, the truth, and the life, Jesus, and that no one comes to the Father except through you. Forgive us of our sin. Turn the hearts of the leaders, Father, for our troops that we are so grateful for. Watch over them each and every day as they serve faithfully, as they give of their lives some many, many years in service to this nation. Bless them. For our care center here, we're thankful for it. It's such a blessing for all the residents there. Watch over them. For all the workers, give them strength. They do an amazing job. Thank you for our first responders. Lord, so often we take them for granted, our firemen and women, our EMTs, ambulance drivers and workers. Thank you for each one of them as well. In Jesus' name, amen. Psalm 63, verses 1 through 3 says, O God, you are my God. Earnestly I seek you. My soul thirsts for you. My body longs for you in a dry and weary land where there is no water. I have seen you in the sanctuary. It's where we're at. And beheld your power and your glory. Because your love is better than life, my lips will glorify you. Let's stand as we sing the doxology, please. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. And Lord, I praise you and worship you. I thank you for this congregation, such a giving congregation in many ways. Certainly in offerings, but far beyond in time, volunteering, in helping special ministries, this Apple Project, Apple Tree Project, and many other things throughout the year. Blessing others far beyond our community. Lord, we love you. We've been blessed incredibly by you. And so this is one way we give out of the blessings you provide. And Lord, most of all, we want your message, the gospel of Jesus Christ, to be proclaimed loud and clear through this body. loud and clear without compromise, that there is no other way to heaven except through you, Jesus, and that your word is true. It is absolutely true. Help us to follow you in your leadership as we desire to be a life-saving station in our community and far beyond. Shine through us, we pray, in Jesus' name. And Lord, we pray together the prayer that you have taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. You may be seated. If the children would come, please, for the Kingdom Kids time.
Good morning, boys and girls. How are you today? Good. It's another nice day. Well, what have we been studying about? 23rd Psalm, right. And who wrote the 23rd Psalm?
David.
And what was David when he was a boy? He was a shepherd boy. And what was he when he was older? He was a king. He was a king. So we're going to go over what we've been studying about with our hand signs with the 23rd Psalm. Okay? Ready? Get up your harp. The 23rd Psalm. Ready, guys? The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life. And that's where we'll stop today, okay? So who remembers what this psalm is talking about? Who is our shepherd? God and Jesus, right? And what do they do? What does it mean they make me to lie down in green pastures? And leads me by still waters. What does that mean? That God and Jesus, they provide for me. They give me the rest I need and all the nourishment that I need. How about he restores my soul? You know, do sometimes we do the wrong thing? Do we don't obey God and all of his commandments, right? Sometimes. Well, when we come back and say, I'm sorry, God, he restores us. He brings us back. He leads us. Sometimes we don't know what we should do in a certain situation. You younger ones, not so much, but you older ones, you're going to be making decisions. He will lead us when we ask him. Sometimes we're going to walk through times in our lives that might be scary or we might be afraid. But who's always with us? He is always with us. He will never leave us. His rod and his staff, they comfort me. Jesus protects us and comforts us when we need it. And we're going to do the table in a couple of weeks, but remember last week we talked about he anoints my head with oil and my cup. What happened to that cup? It overflowed. And what did I give you at the end? Candy. Was it just one piece? No, it was a lot. Did you give some away? Yes. In fact, We that were standing there and greeting you as you left, we got some of your candy too. Well, surely goodness and mercy, that's what we are hand signals. Ready? Surely goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life. Well, I like to think it as this. So I need those, Ivana and Leah to come up here. And let's pick a boy. Who wants to be a helper here? Trent, come on up. So Trent, he loves God, right? Do you, Trent? You do. And you know what it says? You stand there in front. So here's Trent, and he just goes about his day, and we have goodness and mercy. And wherever Trent goes, go, Trent. Go walk around. They follow him. Follow him. And they give him goodness, and God gives us goodness and the good things. And what are some good things, do you think? Yep, everywhere he goes. Everywhere he goes, they go with him. Even when he sits down. Sit down. And when they sit down too, and when he stands up, they follow him. God follows us with goodness, all the good things that we need and we want in our life. What are some good things? What are some good things? Come on, you guys, what are some good things? Yes, he gives us the Bible. He gives us all of those. Oh, really? Okay, Pastor Mike. So wherever he goes, whatever he does, who follows him? Goodness and mercy. All the good things that we need, all the wonderful things. And mercy. Do we ever do things that are wrong? Yeah. Do you ever do things that are wrong at home and your parents say, you're going to get a spanking? Does that ever happen? Well, is there one or sometimes in your life where they change their mind? And they give you mercy. They make you do something else maybe. Well, when we do wrong things, God gives us mercy. He forgives us. So everywhere we go, where are you going to go now? Up there maybe? Okay. Who follows us? Goodness and mercy. All the days of our lives. Okay, thank you. All right, you got to stay there now. Okay, so let's pray, okay? Close your eyes, fold your hands. Father, we thank you so much. We thank you, God, that you, Jesus, are our shepherd, that you take care of us, you provide for us, you watch over us. No matter where we go, you are with us. You forgive us. You give us goodness all of the days of our lives. We thank you for all of that, Lord. And I thank you for these boys and girls as we've been going over this for weeks, that they get it all the way into their heart, knowing that you are their good shepherd. I ask you to bless them wherever they go this week. Give them, help them to be the light and to share that you are our good shepherd with everyone they come in contact with. Protect them and watch over them. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay, you can come get your paper, all right? Thank you. You can just put it in our pew.
So maybe you've heard this story before, but about this verse, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me. There's this little boy that was starting kindergarten, and his mother was very nervous about him walking to school by himself. It was 6-7 blocks. But he told his mom, you are not walking with me to school. And so she had a neighbor lady friend who had a little toddler, and they would walk just for exercise about that time in the morning before school started. So this mother told her neighbor lady, you know, if you're out walking, would you just mind following a ways back my little boy Timmy to school? So not so he sees you so close, but yeah, we'll do that. So little Timmy, about a block down, had a friend, and he'd meet with that friend, and they'd walk the rest of the way to school. So each morning, this neighbor lady mother and her little toddler are out walking, and they just follow behind. And one day, Timmy's friend said, do you know who that lady is? She follows us every day to school. And Timmy says, you know, I don't know her, but I know her name is Shirley Goodness, and her daughter's name is Marcy. Well, how do you know that? Well, every night before we go to bed, the last part of my mom's prayer is, surely goodness and mercy shall follow you all the days of your life. So I guess I just got to get used to her. Yeah. Throw that in there. We're going to sing a chorus here. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. Father, we do thank you for your presence here with us. Our prayer is, as Moses said to you when he was leading the people of Israel out of Egypt through the wilderness, and he pleaded with you, saying, Lord, if your presence does not go with us, we're not moving from this place, because what else will distinguish us from all the other people groups of the world other than your presence? And that is our prayer, Father. We don't just gather here out of ritual or habit. We gather here to meet with you and listen to your word and learn from your word. So thank you for speaking to our hearts by your Spirit. Every time we gather, I pray in Jesus' name. And I ask you to speak through me, Lord, by your Spirit. And so we'll sing that one more time through, Surely the Presence.
Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. I can feel his mighty power and his grace. I can hear the brush of angels' wings. I see glory on each face.
Psalm 23 is where we at. We have today, next Sunday, first Sunday of August is communion. That's when we'll go back to the phrase and finish it all up. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. So join me in the 23rd Psalm. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen. Amen. Just a quick review. Last week was anointing our head with oil, our cup runneth over. We talked about that, the anointing oil with the sheep. Back at this time, the flies, the bugs would torment them then as they do today. The flies with nasal bots would try and crawl up in the sinuses of the sheep, lay their eggs in the sinuses. When they would hatch, it was just tormenting to those sheep. So they would anoint the sheep's head with oil. As I said last week, it was a mixture of linseed oil, sulfur, and tar. Anoint the head to keep those flies away. Today, yeah, we have shots. We have all kinds of other things, dewormers to take care of this, but they still have to be dealt with. And we talked about that, how that compares with the battlefield of our mind and the thoughts that we have to deal with in many different ways as we walk through this earth. But the anointing oil then was also applied to be a blessing to the sheep, so they could grow healthy and strong and be a blessing through their wool, through the lambs, through the chislik that we all love so much. And yes, if you were here last week, we did take Tim and Shirley Dubow to Meridian Corner Monday evening for chislik, their first time to have it. Okay, they were guests with us last Sunday. All right, so verse 6, 6a, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. Follow, that word follow, what does it mean? We know pretty much, but in the Hebrew, if you'd look up a definition, it means to pursue after. She knew the verse I was going on, but I didn't know what she was going to do. That was very good, dear. Yeah. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. It means to chase, to hunt, to run after and overcome will follow us. Surely, the first word of verse 6. If you love grammar, that word in Hebrew is an article of affirmation. If you don't care about grammar, well, a lot of us didn't, but anyway, affirmation is your blank there. What does it mean? Well, it means certainly. It means truly. The psalmist David didn't say, inspired by the Holy Spirit, he didn't say, maybe goodness and mercy will follow you all the days of your life. He didn't say they possibly might follow you all the days of your life. He said, surely, absolutely, without question, those two characteristics of God and many more will follow us as we walk through our years on this life. There's a verse in 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 20 that I was reminded of here. It says this, for no matter how many promises God has made, they are yes in Christ Jesus. They are yes. They are true. God is faithful. He does not change. We sang, I love the chorus of that. Thou changest not, thy compassions, they fail not. And so, if the Lord, this W. Philip Keller, one of the books that I've read on the 23rd Psalm, he was a shepherd all of his adult life. He said, if the Lord Jesus is the guide who leads the flock, then goodness and mercy are the two sheepdogs that guard the flock. Is that good? I like that. If the Lord our shepherd, Jesus, is the one who leads us through this life, then his goodness and his mercy are the sheepdogs that guard the flock as we go. And so he does. He does. Without God's mercy, we would all be dead, just to say it plainly. Without his mercy, because his mercy is when he does not give us what we do deserve. Maybe you've told your child at different times they've done something, and you might say to them, you know what, you deserve a spanking today. But I'm going to be merciful to you this time. You don't get what you deserve. God's mercy towards us is incredible. His mercy is, again, as Lamentation says in the hymns, morning by morning, new mercies I see. That's what I've said it before. I love the morning time in many ways, but largely because of that verse. No matter what happened yesterday, today, and so often I say, Lord, thank you for this day. Thank you for your mercies that are new. We start out fresh. We start out new today. So just two thoughts I want to look through on this verse. There's more than this, but two I'm going to look at. Two thoughts on this verse 6. First of all, very obvious from the verse, God follows us and he pursues us all the days of our lives. For protection, yes, but for so that we can come to know him better and walk with him closer. And in these days that we live in, especially turbulent times around the world, And we know everything instantaneously. You know, on your phones, you have different apps. Maybe you have weather apps. I have AccuWeather, which I often call InAccuWeather. That's what I call it. But, you know, you're getting, if there's a, I don't know, earthquake in Brazil. Bing! Oh, wow, registered what? Not. If there's a tsunami warning, I think there's one not so long ago, off the coast of Alaska. Bing! You know, that's where we live. And we see good things around the world. But most often what's on the news is the tragedy, the destruction, the evil, and it's hard to watch, doesn't it? Where 100 years ago, just over, you know, it took a long time for news to travel. And now it's instant. So we got to know these truths, the truths of Psalm 23, to hold us steady, to help us to stand firm against all the works of the enemy, because otherwise it's very easy to get discouraged. But God is faithful, and he is true, and he is just, and it's going to be, he's going to come back for his church. It's going to happen. We call that the rapture. You know, we talk about that often. And then he's coming back on his second coming to the Mount of Olives. It is going to happen. Sooner than we think. It is. We got to be ready. We got to stand strong. We got to encourage each other. And what a beautiful psalm to do so. So, I want to look at like 5 points of scripture, examples. Just, maybe you're not thinking of it, but how God pursues his people. He loves you so much. He knows what you're going through. He knows the struggles. He knows the joys. He knows if you're hiding from him. Yeah? He knows if we're trying to, we think, avoid him, which we can't. Let's go back all the way to the beginning in Genesis. Adam and Eve. A lot of these blanks you might guess. Adam and Eve. After the sin, what'd they do? They hid. In the garden, right? Covered himself with fig leaves, tried to make their own covering for their sin. All of a sudden they realized, we don't have any clothes on. Never knew it before. Everything was perfect. Sin came in, they hid, tried to cover themselves. And you know what? Did God just say, yeah, your fault, forget you? No. They hid from the Lord God among the trees in the garden, but the Lord God called to the man, where are you? And we all know God knew very well where they were. He wanted a confession out of Adam's mouth of what they had done. He went looking. Goodness, in his mercy, he went to them. Second, Moses, we come up to. Exodus chapter 2. That God had shown him that he was to be the deliverer of the people of Israel in bondage in Egypt. And he was realizing that, and he was going to follow God's plan. And he's out among the Hebrew people, that's the Jewish people, and he sees an Egyptian slave master just whipping the tar out of one of the Hebrew slaves. And Moses got so angry. He looked to see if anybody was around. He didn't think there was. And he kills that Egyptian slave driver and buries him in the sand. And then thinks nobody knows it except the guy that he rescued. The next day he goes out among the Hebrew people again. And two of the Hebrew people are fighting with each other. And he tells them to stop. And they, well, who made you the ruler over us? You're going to kill us and bury us in the sand like you did that guy yesterday? And he was so overcome with grief and fear, he fled out into the desert, back to where his father-in-law was. What was his father-in-law doing, and what did he have Moses do then? Herd sheep. He was herding sheep. So basically, he was running from God's plan. And he's on the far side of the desert and goes up there on Mount Horeb to the mountain of God, and that's where he sees the burning bush. And if you'd read on in there, chapter 3, what does it say? God called to him. God called to him. His goodness and mercy following after. Even when Moses thought, I've blown it. I'm sure he thought, I cannot deliver these people out of Egypt, God. Can't do it. I'm a murderer, killed that man. You cannot use me. Thank God for his goodness and his mercy. Number three, Jonah. Jonah, we all know about him. God wanted him to preach to that city of Nineveh, that wicked city. Jonah didn't want to. He was scared. He gets on that boat that was going to Tarshish. I looked that up this morning, how far it was from Nineveh across the sea to Tarshish. 2,500 miles. On boat at that time, 3,000 years ago-ish. You know how far it would have been when from where Jonah was when God told him to do this to Nineveh? 60 miles. But he wasn't going there. And of course we know God said, nope, you are not getting away from me. You know, God has ways of getting our attention. And it's not always good. But he'll do what he has to do. And God had that plan for Jonah. And that's what he wanted him to do. And he was going to get him there no matter what it took. And so, you know, we all know the story. He sends that great big fish, swallows him up, takes him back over there to Nineveh, pukes him out of his mouth. And there used to be a song about that, imagine how he must have stunk, probably bleached out by the acids in that whale, the big fish's stomach and all that, the seaweed, and there he goes. The guy says, who wouldn't have repented hearing Jonah preach? His goodness and his mercy. You say, well, that doesn't sound like goodness. It is. It is God's goodness. The disciples coming up to the New Testament, Mark 6:48. They're in the boat. Jesus is not in the boat. He tells them, go to the other side. I'll meet you there. Sea of Galilee. The storm comes up. They're rowing. Scared, very scared. And the fourth watch of the night, the Bible says, Jesus comes to them walking on the water. You know what time the fourth watch of the night is? The fourth watch starts at 3:00 in the morning. They had been rowing all that time against that storm. Because, you know, if you go back, in earlier in Mark, is when the same scenario, except Jesus was in the boat sleeping, told them to go to the other side, storm comes up, they get scared, they panic, they quit rowing. Jesus! And he gets after them. Oh, you have little faith. Why didn't you keep rowing that boat? This time, I can just imagine on that boat, Peter saying, we are not stopping rowing this boat. I'm not going to have him tell me again, you have little faith. So they keep going, and he comes walking on the water. And what does he do? It says Jesus, went out to them. He went out to them. I'm just trying to get this over. If we think when we're in hard times and we think, where are you, God? He knows, and he's reaching out through people, through different ways. He is. Last one I'll mention here, Peter and the disciples, John 21. This is after the cross. And Peter's so discouraged from denying the Lord those three times when he promised him he wouldn't. And remember, the rooster crows, and he is nearby, and he's watching what's happening to Jesus, being whipped and everything. And the rooster crows. Jesus makes eye contact with him, and Peter just wept, and went out from that place. Sure felt like a complete failure. And it was after this, he says, I'm going fishing. What about that was his career? What's that statement? It was, what was he saying? He says, I know the Lord cannot use me. I'm going back to my career of fishing. And they're out on the boat, remember, all night. They're not catching anything. And Jesus called out to them. All five of these. He's taking the initiative. He's reaching out to them, to us. And so they realized, because they had a big, haven't you any fish? And they catch this boatload of fish, and Jesus says, it's the Lord. And off he jumps off the boat and swims to him. All kinds of examples on that. Surely goodness and mercy will follow you all the days of your life. Not just some of the days of your life, all. I want to just share this. Tim and Shirley DeBow, who were with us last weekend, he shared, those of you that were here, he's the Mideast regional pastor in the Four Seas. So Pennsylvania, Ohio, Michigan, up into Canada, about six or seven states, I forget the others. But what a blessing to have him, and we had him Sunday night and Monday night with us, and they left Tuesday morning. So we got to visit a lot. He was sharing how him and Shirley came to know the Lord. Truly amazing. Neither one of them were raised in church, not raised in a Christian home at all. Didn't know about God, didn't know about Jesus. And I didn't ask their age. My guess would be they're about 70, okay? So, how did you come to know the Lord? He said, we were young adults, newly married. He was working for a carpenter in construction out in, way out east, doesn't matter where. He said, you know that, my boss, the head carpenter, he was a strong believer. Every day at work on that radio, he played the Billy Graham sermons all day long, loudly. I hated it. I did not want to listen to it. Every day, every day, every day. And he never said much to the guy. It's just what he did, the boss. One day, he said, they were building this house, and the plumber was there the same day, roughing in all that stuff. Radio was going. They sort of had their lunch together. He said, you know what? At lunchtime, I watched my boss go sit by that plumber, talk to him about Jesus. The plumber responded, yes, I would like to know Jesus. The boss led him through a prayer of salvation, received Christ. Tim's over here just watching this in amazement because he's been totally resistant all the time. And he said, you know, it was maybe 2 weeks later, I went to my boss and I said, I'd like to know Jesus. Would you pray with me? Yeah. So he does. He goes home that night. Tell Shirley, you know what happened today? I received Christ as Lord and Savior. Would you like to? Yes, I would. So he's trying to remember how that went with him and prays with her. And they start growing, and they didn't get in church right away, but 5 years. And then his career was with Gillette for a lot of years. Was active in his church, on mission trips, everything. God called him to seminary, so he was a second career pastor. They served in Salem, Connecticut. He pastored that church for 20 years, and now is a regional pastor. So you never know what God is doing, how he's working his goodness and his mercy in any of our lives. Don't be discouraged. Don't think it's not happening. His goodness and mercy, why? The second thought, this will be shorter, I'll sort of round it off here. The blessings, if you fill in your blank, this is letter B. What blessings are you leaving behind? That ties in with my cup runneth over. We need to think about that as we live our lives. What blessings are you leaving behind? Well, what blessings does a sheep leave behind? Well, the wool, the meat. That's not your blank, though. Manure, that's your blank, manure, okay? And I've read, in the book I read, it said this, sheep manure is the best balanced manure of any domestic livestock. Now, that's what this author said, I don't know. When scattered efficiently over the pastures, it provides enormous benefit to the soil and is one of the best fertilizers. Pastures flourish if managed correctly. Now, I know hog manure around here is very desirable and a great fertilizer. A lot of you use that. And so what are we leaving behind as Christians? Well, we don't want to be leaving that behind, right? No, that goes in the toilet or the outhouse, whichever. What are we leaving behind? We got to think about this. Here's some scenarios, okay, to think on. Peace or turmoil? What am I leaving behind? Joy or frustration? What am I leaving? Contentment or conflict? Love or division? Forgiveness or bitterness? Gentleness or rigid control? Goodness and mercy or hurt and pain? All those things. Maybe we think, how do I leave my house in the morning? How do I leave my job at the end of the day? How do I leave a family gathering? How do I leave a sporting event when my team doesn't win or the refs were terrible? Our best example, of course, is Jesus, always. Acts 10:38 says, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and power, and how he went around doing good and healing all who were under the power of the devil, because God was with him. Now, yeah, there were two times, when Jesus went in the temple and overturned the money changers' tables and chased everybody out of there, that was turning God's house of prayer into a den of robbers. Yes, there was those times too. Thank God for his goodness and mercy following us all the day of our lives. Every day, he is your shepherd in the paths of righteousness. He's your shepherd through the valley of the shadow of death. Let's pray. Thank you, Lord, that you are. Thank you for your goodness and your mercy every day of our lives. You're there when we don't even realize it, when we don't even feel like it. Maybe, Lord, when we even say, I don't think you're with me, you still are there with us. And help us to extend that to others as we live our lives, shining as bright stars in the universe, holding forth the word of life, your word, the very word of God. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. 444, if you want to stand, I love to tell the story. Let's stand. I love to tell the story of unseen things above, of Jesus and his glory, of Jesus and his love. I love to tell the story because I know 'tis true. It satisfies my longings as nothing else can do. And I love to tell the story. 'Twill be my theme in glory to tell the old story of Jesus and his love. I love to tell the story, more wonderful it seems than all the golden fancies of all our golden dreams. I love to tell the story. It did so much for me, and that is just the reason I tell it now to thee. And I love to tell the story. 'Twill be my theme in glory to tell the old story of Jesus and his love. I love to tell the story, 'tis pleasant to repeat. What seems each time I tell it more wonderfully sweet. I love to tell the story, for some have never heard the message of salvation from God's own holy word. And I love to tell the story, 'twill be my theme in glory, to tell the old story of Jesus and his love. I love to tell the story for those who know it best, seem hungering and thirsting to hear it like the rest. And when in scenes of glory I sing the new song, 'twill be the old story that I have loved so long. And I love to tell the story, 'twill be my theme in glory, to tell the old story of Jesus and his love. Amen. Please receive the benediction. And now may the Lord go with you. May he go ahead of you to guide you, behind you to encourage you, beside you to befriend you, above you to watch over you, and within you to give you his peace. Amen. And as a prayer for our nation, we sing, God bless America. God bless America, land that I love. Stand beside her and guide her through the night with the light from above. From the mountains to the prairies to the oceans white with foam, God bless America, my home, sweet home. God bless America, my home, sweet home. God bless America, land that I love. Stand beside her and guide her through the night with the light from above. From the mountains to the prairies to the oceans white with foam, God bless America, my home, sweet home. God bless America, my home, sweet home. Amen. You may be seated. Puts a smile on my face seeing a little 5-year-old with her eyes closed singing that with all her heart. Amen. Thank you, Cindy, for the beautiful music.